It's like Cindy, she used to go to UC, she studied musical, so she got it off. And we was living in an upstairs apartment, and she, about 3 weeks before that opera started, she got her, what she was going to say. And she'd go get into a part of that, and maybe she'd run them same 3, 4, 5 lines for 2 or 3 hours. And I mean, an opera singer's voice carries that. I just finally had to walk across and said, you got to shut up, babe. I just can't. You can do that or get on something else, but I done learned this part of the piece.
Yeah.
You don't like opera? She said, fine, but you've been singing the same 3 bars for the past 3 hours. I can't tell the difference. Because I can sit, you know, at the church down there, get out from underneath the balcony, get up on the floor. I can point to my finger where she's standing in the back of the bar. Yeah. You know, yeah. She just hated me sometimes. She was going to do the mopper and do the same stuff.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and get started.
Might as well.
Yeah. So, thank you for braving the elements to be here this evening. And we'll go ahead and we'll start at the beginning of chapter 5 to sort of by way of summary, since it's been a couple of weeks. We finished up talking about Elijah and his ministry as a prophet and how he sort of then handed that ministry on to Elisha, who had been his disciple. And we talked about how that transition between Elijah and Elisha, sort of Elijah who came pronouncing judgment, and then Elisha who comes bringing restoration, became the paradigm that the Israelites had for what the Messiah was going to do. And so they had that tradition that Elijah was going to come first, and then the Messiah was going to come. Elijah was going to come to pronounce judgment, and then the Messiah was going to come to restore Israel. And so this is why when we get into the Gospels in the New Testament, you know, when Jesus asks, who do people say that I am? One of the first things they say is, well, some say you're Elijah. And you say, well, what's that all about? Well, that's because of this paradigm that they have in their heads. And this is why St. John the Forerunner is identified as coming in the spirit and power of Elijah. That he's seen as the one who sort of fulfills that role that Elijah had, being the forerunner of Jesus as the Messiah. Okay, so we talked, that was our main focus last time, was that transition. And we saw how sort of Elisha did a lot of the same kind of miracles that Elijah had done, but sort of did them one better. And we talked about that concept of fulfillment. Now, fulfillment doesn't just mean like there's a promise in the Old Testament and that promise is kept in the New Testament, or the Old Testament predicts something is going to happen and then it happens, but that fulfillment is sort of like a filling up to overflowing. Like Christ takes what's in the Old Testament and then does it sort of one better, or 10 better, or 100 better, or infinitely better, you know. So we go from being promised a little piece of land to being promised the whole world and eternal life. You know, there's this shift. We go from, you know, being promised that they'd be victorious over their enemies, being physical people who attack them, to Christ being victorious over death itself. Right? So it's sort of, we go from this little to bigger. This bigger fulfillment.
Do they ever reach a place in the Old Testament where they start thinking that there isn't, you know, the righteous people go to heaven? Or is there,
well,
or do you always just die and it's
no, there is. And we're going to, as we go forward, especially once we get into the prophets and into some of the wisdom literature, we're going to be able to see how that develops. We're not there yet. At this point in history, they still think about the grave. And there's this idea that we'll see in the Psalms that people have, that even if I go into the grave, Hades or Sheol, God will be with me. But what all that entails and the bodily resurrection and that isn't really all there yet. So, but we'll see how that develops. And we're also going to see here how, I mean, we're still seeing how the concept of Messiah develops too. You know, we had this promise back in Genesis of the seed of the woman who was going to come and sort of fix everything. And then we kind of were introduced to the concept of like Moses as a prophet leader, that whoever this was going to be something like Moses. And then we're introduced now to the concept of a king, and David is sort of the paradigm for a good king, and the idea that it's going to be one of his descendants. And we're going to see here as we get through the end of 2 Kings, and especially in 1 and 2 Chronicles that come next, how that evolves into the idea where Israel is expecting a king to come and establish a kingdom on earth. So that's we're sort of in midstream here. And we shouldn't think of this as if like somehow God and how he's dealing with people changed. Right? I mean, Enoch we have who goes straight into eternal life. We already have Elijah who goes up into heaven on a right on a chariot. But in terms of God explaining these ideas and conveying these ideas to human beings, you know, there's a process of how much human beings can understand conceptually. You know, and we've already talked about as we've gone through, just the things that God drops on Moses are mind-boggling in terms of the Bronze Age, where he says the idea that there's only one God and he's the God of the whole world. You know? And he made the whole world by himself, and he doesn't have to fight off any other gods. You know? And I mean, all those concepts were totally revolutionary and mind-blowing at the time God conveyed them, but human beings can only sort of handle so much at a time. And as we've seen historically too, it's not like the Israelites have been real obedient to what they have been given, where God would give them more yet. You know, they haven't really done a lot of good things with what they've been given. So that slows the process too. That's just that famous quote from St. Cyril on the Athenite, who was a monastic in the 20th century, who he was asked about technology. You know, everyone sort of assumed that he'd poo-poo would be anti-technology, you know, because he's this monk. And he said that if we were more obedient to God, and if we were more godly people, God would have given us more technology. Because he'd trust us to use it.
I like that.
So he sort of said the exact opposite. So a lot of times it's us that slows down the process. It's not that God's changing or God just likes being sneaky and dropping hints and riddles. It's that he communicates with us in a language we understand. He doesn't show up to Moses speaking King James English. He doesn't, you know, and using Greek philosophical categories, right? He shows up and speaks to him in the language he understands. So, I think I answered your question that went far afield. Any other questions before we get started tonight about what we've been talking about? Okay. So chapter 5, verse 1. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. There were Arameans, that's the Syria or the Syrians. Yeah. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him the Lord had given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Remember, what's this about Yahweh giving victory to Aram? Remember, this was against Ahab. Remember, this was part of God's judgment against the kings of Israel who were being unfaithful, is that he brought their neighbors in to attack them, and he gave them victory over the northern kingdom of Israel, because the northern kingdom of Israel is worshiping Baal instead of him. So verse 2, now bands from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, if only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy. This leprosy, we don't know exactly what disease it was, because the word that's used for leprosy in the Bible basically can refer to a whole bunch of different degenerative skin conditions, bad skin conditions. Most commonly, what's referred to as leprosy is a particular type of wasting disease that basically causes you to rot, starting with your extremities. So you start losing fingers and toes. And so when you have this disease, not only do you have the obvious physical problems, but at this point in history, you're completely socially ostracized because they had no idea how these diseases worked, how they were transmitted. And so once you got one of these diseases, you were an outcast from society, and you're going to be a beggar for the rest of your life, and the rest of your life wasn't going to be pleasant. So this is a pretty horrible thing to befall you, to have this. So even though this guy is a high-ranking commander and he's well-respected by everybody, he's got this horrible ailment. His wife happens to have an Israelite slave from the northern kingdom, and this Israelite slave knows of Elisha, at least by reputation, and says if you could meet Elisha, he could cure this leprosy. So verse 4, Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel had said. By all means go, the king of Aram replied. I will send a letter to the king of Israel. So Naaman left, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of Israel said, with this letter I am sending my servant Naaman to you, so that you may cure him of his leprosy. As soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robes and said, am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? See how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me. Okay, so somewhere there's a breakdown in the communication. So they send all these gifts to the king of Israel so that the king of Israel could cure him of his leprosy. Well, the king of Israel, right, and this was in this case, Joram, who's Ahab's son, right, he can't cure any leprosy, right? So he looks at it and says, this must be the king of Aram trying to start another war with me, right? He's going to send me all these gifts and ask me to do it. I can't do it. He's going to use that as an excuse to try to go to war. When Elisha the man of God heard that the king of Israel had torn his robes, he sent him this message, why have you torn your robes? Have the man come to me and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel. So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. So this slave girl, the Israelite slave girl in Syria, okay, believes that God's prophet can heal leprosy. But when the king of Israel meets this guy with leprosy, his response is, you can't cure leprosy. Right? Doesn't even think of Elisha. Doesn't occur to him, oh yeah, there's a prophet in Israel. Right? But he does make a good admission at least. Notice he says, am I God? Can I kill people and bring them back to life? Why, no, king of Israel, you can't. Right? You can't.
It's interesting. We're just talking about the resurrection. What
he's saying. Yeah. So he can't do that. The idea being, only Yahweh can. Okay. So Naaman goes over to Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to say to him, go wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored and you will be cleansed. But Naaman went away angry and said, I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Right? So he says, go wash 7 times in the Jordan River. Right? He's going, I thought he was going to come out and, you know, call on his God and do some hocus pocus and, you know, leprosy disappear? You know, I don't have time for all this. He says, are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than any of the waters of Israel? Right? He says, we got much cleaner rivers where I come from. Right? I don't want to go down to that ditch. You wash the river? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed? So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servants went to him and said, my father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, wash and be cleansed? Right? So they come up to him and they say, well, if you've gone to the prophet and he said, I want you to donate, you know, some huge amount of gold, or I want you to, you know, go and take this pilgrimage to this holy place, or aren't you going there's, if he told you to do something like that, you would have done it, wouldn't you? Why don't you just go bathe in the Jordan River? Right? This isn't that big of a deal, right? just go give it a try. So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times, as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. So again, we have this emphasis on it's not just the leprosy goes away, right? But his flesh is restored like a child, you know, all the spots and the scars and the, you know, everything else he'd accumulated over his life, all gone. So this is another emphasis of that, you know, fulfillment, that idea of sort of this abounding goes beyond even what you could expect. Then Naaman and all his attendants went back to the man of God. He stood before him and said, now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel. Please accept now a gift from your servant. The prophet answered, as surely as the Lord lives whom I serve, I will not accept a thing. And even though Naaman urged him, he refused. If you will not, said Naaman, please let me, your servant, be given as much earth as a pair of mules can carry. For your servant will never again make burnt offerings and sacrifices to any other god but the Lord. But may the Lord forgive your servant for this one thing. When my master enters the temple of Rimmon to bow down, and he is leaning on my arm, and I bow down there also, when I bow down in the temple of Rimmon, may the Lord forgive your servant for this. So he says, now I fully know, since he just was miraculously cured over what was basically a death sentence, says, I now know that your God here who you worship is the only God. And interestingly, this shows you a little window into how people thought at this time in history, around 800 BC, that in his mind, if he's going to make sacrifices to the God of Israel, right, he needs to build the altar in Israel, so he wants to take a bunch of soil from Israel there and take it back with him to Syria so that he can build an altar on top of it to Yahweh. So even though on one hand he's made this confession that your God is the only God in all the world, he's still in his head, his way of thinking, he's like, well, this is the God of this one country. Right?
You gotta hedge his bet.
Well, no, but so that shows you a little window into how he thinks. And then his second request is, he apparently has to go, you know, he's right under the king, he's the commander of the army, he has to go with the king when they go to this temple, this pagan temple in Damascus, right? And apparently when the king goes there, and when he bows in front of the idol, he holds on to this guy's arm as he bows down, and so he's saying, I kind of have to go with him still, because of my job. He said, I don't really believe it anymore, but I hope your God can forgive me for the fact that I still have to go in there with him. So verse 19, go in peace, Elisha said. So notice Elisha doesn't say, no, you can't ever walk into that pagan temple again. You need to go back and confess Yahweh in front of the king of Aram, even if he kills you. Right? He doesn't say that. He says, go in peace. He says, okay. He says, okay, I will accept that as the best you can do. Right? It's the best you, at the point you're at, the best you can do. After Naaman had traveled some distance, Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, the man of God, said to himself, "My master was too easy on Naaman this Aramean by not accepting from him what he brought. As surely as the Lord lives, I'll run after him and get something from him." So Gehazi, who we've already met a little bit, who's Elisha's servant, he says, "Man, that guy got off easy." He says, "He came here, he got cured of leprosy, didn't give us any money, didn't give us any gifts, and not only that, you know, Elisha let him off on the whole going to the temple thing, and the whole, you know, I mean, that's getting off awful easy. I think I'm going to track him down and see if I can't, you know, get a little tip off the top for the whole curing his leprosy thing. You think that'd be worth something?" So Gehazi hurried after Naaman. When Naaman saw him running toward him, he got down from the chariot to meet him. "Is everything all right?" he asked. "Everything is all right," Gehazi answered. "My master sent me to say, 2 young men from the company of the prophets have just come to me from the hill country of Ephraim. Please give them a talent of silver and 2 sets of clothing." Now, did Elisha say that to Gehazi?
No.
Are there any such 2 young men? No. Okay. But so this is the story he comes up with. Okay. And 2 talents of silver is about 75 pounds. So that's not a small amount. That's not like $2. That's okay. "By all means, take 2 talents," said Naaman. He urged Gehazi to accept them and then tied up the 2 talents of silver in 2 bags with 2 sets of clothing. He gave them to 2 of his servants and they carried them ahead of Gehazi. Okay. So Naaman, he's happy he's cured of his leprosy. So he's like, "Hey, sure, I would have given you a lot more than that. Go ahead, you know, take it." Sends a couple servants to carry it for him. When Gehazi came to the hill, he took the things from the servants and put them away in the house. He sent the men away and they left. Then he went in and stood before his master Elisha. "Where have you been, Gehazi?" Elisha asked. "Your servant didn't go anywhere," Gehazi answered. Now Gehazi's been hanging around with Elisha for a while now. You'd think he might know that he's not going to get away with this. Verse 26, "But Elisha said to him, 'Was not my spirit with you when the man got down from his chariot to meet you? Is this the time to take money or to accept clothes, olive groves, vineyards, flocks, herds, or menservants and maidservants? Naaman's leprosy will cling to you and to your descendants forever.' Then Gehazi went from Elisha's presence, and he was leprous as white as snow." So Gehazi and his descendants end up with the leprosy that got cured from Naaman, because he decided to get greedy. So chapter 6.
Is this a time for Judas?
Not for Judas necessarily, but we talked a little bit last time about how right now Israel isn't following God. Right? And by that I mean both the temple structure, which in the northern kingdom is mainly a temple to Baal in the first place, but even where they are worshiping Yahweh, it's at the golden calves at Bethel and Dan, right? So their official religion's a mess, their king is a mess, right? Their king isn't worshiping Yahweh. So this community of prophets is essentially God's people on earth now. So it is. Like the church. And so because of that, because God's presence is there, particularly with his primary prophet Elisha, things take on an increased significance. I mentioned last time Ananias and Sapphira in the book of Acts. Remember when they come and they lie to Peter about how much money they've given to the church. They sell a piece of property and bring the money. Peter says, "Is this all the money you got for the property?" And they go, "Yeah." And drop dead. And Peter says, "You didn't lie to men, you lied to God." Right? Well, it's the same thing here. This prophetic community right now is the people of God. So when Gehazi does this, he's not just lying to Elisha. He's lying to God. And he's not just trying to con Elisha, he's trying to con God.
That's why I was thinking. Right hand man, supposedly.
Well, Gehazi.
And sell for a lot less than 2 pounds of silver.
Gehazi, as we'll see, isn't really much of a disciple. It's not like Elijah was Elisha's mentor, you know, and Elisha was his disciple and a prophet. Gehazi's more like a butler. Gehazi doesn't really, as we're going to see, well, from this incident and from other incidents coming up. Well, no, but Judas, the difference with Judas is, Judas, for example, worked miracles. You know, the Gospels don't say Jesus gave 11 of his 12 disciples the ability to work miracles and sent them out. It says he gave his 12 disciples the ability to work miracles and sent them out. So Judas worked miracles. Judas
had the power.
Spoke prophecy. Everything that Jesus did for any of his 12 disciples, he did for Judas too. All the abilities, all the privileges, all the everything. And Judas still chose to betray him. I'm cutting Gehazi a little slack. By saying that Gehazi wasn't really a prophet. He really wasn't a full member of that community. He still held to a pretty high standard. But it's not quite the same level of betrayal with Gehazi and Elisha as it was with Judas and Christ. I'm cutting Gehazi a little slack.
Here they call him just a servant.
So yeah, he's a servant or a slave. Yeah, not a disciple per se. So chapter 6, verse 1, the company of the prophets said to Elisha. Now remember, the company of the prophets is this community. Sort of like it's sort of like a monastic community today. Look, the place where we meet with you is too small for us. Let us go to the Jordan where each of us can get a pole, and let us build a place there for us to live. And he said, go. Then one of them said, won't you please come with your servants? I will, Elisha replied, and he went with them. They went to the Jordan and began to cut down trees. As one of them was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. Oh, my Lord, he cried out, it was borrowed. So they go and they're chopping down these trees. There's not enough room where they're staying, so they're going to go stay in the Jordan River Valley where there's more room. They go and they're cutting down trees, and the axe head comes off the handle, right? Flies into the river and sinks. And the guy who lost it says, I borrowed this axe. Right? So that's not good, because now somebody's going to be without an axe. The man of God asked, where did it fall? When he showed him the place, Elisha cut a stick and threw it there and made the iron float. Lift it out, he said, and the man reached out his hand and took it. So this is another minor miracle. You think, well, okay, that's nice for the guy who almost lost an axe.
Interesting. If the guy had jumped in the water and just been in the Jordan River, would that have been a problem? Is it because he's a prophet that he was better than he jumped in the river?
Well, not necessarily, just it would be hard to find in the muddy bottom of the river, you know, once it sank. But the idea here is, this miracle, I mean, the other miracles we've just read probably seem more impressive to us than this one. This one, however, was considered at the time. This was sort of the pinnacle of Elisha's miracles. Yes, even more than raising someone from the dead. Because something made of iron floating in water means that the whole order of nature, the whole way the world works, what we would call the laws of physics, right, have gotten turned on their head. Right? So this isn't just about the life or death of one human being, or about healing a disease for one human being, or about making a little bit of bread go a long way. Right? This is the whole realm of nature being obedient to what Elisha says rather than to the regular rules. So this is bigger scale in their mind because of that. This is like when Joshua made the sun stand still in the sky. Right? This is a big, even though we think, you know, the axe head floating. So that's how we need to understand this. That God, through Elisha, is in control of those very quote-unquote laws of nature. not vice versa.
I often wonder, when these miracles, why do they have to do things like cut a twig, throw it in? I don't get the significance.
Well, I talked a little bit how, and we're going to see a lot of this later, and it's going to get weirder and weirder. the prophets not only speak prophetic things, but they do prophetic actions. Now, where have we seen before where someone hit water with a stick?
Well,
Moses. When he was calling out the plagues first, and then when he split the Red Sea.
Yeah.
Red Sea. He also struck the rock with his rod and brought forth the water. So I would say that in this case, the stick, the action of throwing the stick, it's not like it was a ritual that he had to do to make the accent flow, but it's hitting the Jordan River with the stick is calling back to those previous times where God, through his prophet, changed the laws of nature, turned the Nile River into blood, brought frogs brought flies out of everything, out of the dust on the ground. It's harkening back to those other times. And it's calling
just, it's
them back
to. It's tough to, even when you look at what we just read, bathing seven times. Well, the only thing I understand of it is one of obedience when you do that.
Right, test of obedience.
You're humbling yourself.
And it's a dirty river.
And it's not a great task.
And this is a guy of a noble station. Class, yeah. Noble station.
Yeah.
Being told to go to this dingy.
Yes.
And go wash in it, even though it's probably dirtier than he is. Yeah. So, and we're going to see, when I say it's going to get weirder, like when we get into the book of Ezekiel, he's going to start walking around town naked.
Yeah.
He's going to... At one point, he's gonna put himself in stocks and walk around and stuff. So we're gonna see a lot of that. But there's both, and even in the life of Christ, I mean, there are times where he does prophetic actions, like when he goes and clears the moneylenders out of the temple. Right, that's symbolic of cleansing and purifying the temple. Not just throwing those couple of guys out. that actually has a larger significance that's being communicated.
I know what you mean. Yeah. But I'm just amazed that even Jesus' miracles, why he needed to do that. And yet the woman touches him and he said he touches him.
Yeah. Well, and another example would be the man born blind who he takes and spits on the ground and takes.
Yeah, why?
Well, in that case, he's, you know, again, he's hearkening back to, you know, how did God form man? Out of the dirt. So this man was born blind. He's creating eyes for the man.
Wow.
It's calling us back to that story, showing that he's God, and he's, just as he created man in the first place, he's able to recreate man now. So a lot of cases, the first place to go when you see a prophetic action like that is to think about what goes before it in the Bible. What might it be calling us back? What story might it remind us of previously that it might be trying to connect us up with? Okay, so we're at verse 8, chapter 6. Now the king of Aram was at war with Israel. After conferring with his officers, he said, "I will set up my camp in such and such a place." The man of God sent word to the king of Israel, "Beware of passing that place because the Arameans are going down there." So the king of Israel checked on the place indicated by the man of God. Time and again, Elisha warned the king so that he was on his guard in such places. This enraged the king of Aram. He summoned his officers and demanded of them, "Will you not tell me which of us is on the side of the king of Israel?" Okay, so he keeps setting up ambushes, basically. He keeps setting up ambushes to try and get the king of Israel to capture him, probably hold him for ransom, right, and ultimately take over Israel. So he keeps setting up these ambushes. Every time he sets up an ambush, Elisha sends a message to the king of Israel saying, "Don't go over here, don't go over there." And so he keeps missing the ambushes. So finally, the king of the Syrians calls all his officers and says, okay, who's the leak? Right? Who keeps telling Israel where we're setting up the ambushes? One of you must be a traitor, must be telling them. Verse 12, none of us, my lord the king, said one of his officers, but Elisha, the prophet who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel the very words you speak in your bedroom. So it doesn't. It's not just, you know, what you announce. You could go hide in your own bedroom and whisper something to somebody, and Elisha's going to know about it. So there's nothing we can do. Right? There's nothing we can do. Don't look at us. Go find out where he is, the king ordered, so I can send men and capture him. Okay, so there's his logic. Well, okay. I'll go get this Elisha guy, and then we'll make sure he doesn't tell the king of Israel like where Elijah's I'm going to be. The report came back, he is in Dothan. Then he sent horses and chariots and a strong force there. They went by night and surrounded the city. Okay. So Elisha's in this city, Dothan, right? They wake up in the morning, whole city surrounded by chariots and troops. But the Arameans all there after Elisha. So verse 15, when the servant of the man of God, here he is again, our friend Gehazi, got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. Oh my Lord, what shall we do? The servant asked. Don't be afraid, the prophet answered. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Okay, so Gehazi's like, you know, we're surrounded. You know, what are we going to do? You got some way to sneak out of here? What's going to happen? And Elisha says, don't worry. We've got more guys on our side than they've got on their side.
Uh-huh. Where?
So Gehazi, even though he has leprosy, he's still hanging around.
Yeah. And Elisha prayed, "O Lord, open his eyes so he may see." Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. And so he prays, and all of a sudden, he sees what? God's army. Right? So he sees not one chariot like took Elijah up into heaven, but chariots, angels, right, all over the place, who are all there to protect Elisha from the Arameans. As the enemy came down toward him, Elisha prayed to the Lord, strike these people with blindness. So he struck them with blindness as Elisha had asked. Elisha told them, this is not the road and this is not the city. Follow me and I will lead you to the man you are looking for. And he led them to Samaria. So the picture here is, these guys are all here to get Elisha. Okay. So he prays to God and says, make them blind. Now, he doesn't mean literally make them all so they can't see. Right? He means so that they can't see him. And Elisha walks out to all these guys who have come there to capture him and says, you got the wrong city. Follow me and I'll show you where the guy you're looking for is. Okay? And he led them to Samaria. So he leads them to the capital. The capital of Israel. After they entered the city, Elisha said, Lord, open the eyes of these men so they can see. Then the Lord opened their eyes and they looked. So apparently, they're clueless. And all of a sudden they realize, wait a second, we're all in the capital of Israel. Like the fortified capital of Israel where the king is with all his army and everything. Right? So they come to and suddenly realize this. The Lord opened their eyes and they looked. There they were inside Samaria. When the king of Israel saw them, he asked Elisha, shall I kill them, my father? Shall I kill them? Now, notice how the relationship with the king of Israel has changed. Elisha saved his life a few times right, from ambushes. Now all of a sudden, he's got a lot of respect for Elisha. Right? So he comes to him and he says, hey, thanks for bringing all these enemy troops here. Should I go ahead and kill them now? Now that you've brought them here. Do not kill them, he answered. Would you kill men you have captured with your own sword or bow? Set food and water before them so that they may eat and drink and then go back to their master. So he says, you can't kill them. You wouldn't kill a captured prisoner, right, in cold blood. So he says, give them food and water and send them back home. So he prepared a great feast for them. And after they had finished eating and drinking, he sent them away, and they returned to their master. So the bands from Aram stopped raiding Israel's territory. Okay? So he gives them a big... Instead of killing them, remember, these are the enemy troops, he gives them a big feast and sends them home, with the result that it ends the war. It ends the war. So... What principle is
love?
Is this showing?
Love your enemies.
Right? Do good to those who hate you. This is a big object lesson, right? These people came there to kill Elisha, right? And he takes them to a big party in their honor. Right? So that's, again, I've talked about this before as we've been going through the Old Testament. People talk about Old Testament God, mean, angry, vengeful. They're the New Testament. God loves everyone and wants you to love your enemies. Well, this is the middle of the Old Testament. God wanted them to love their enemies then too. Right? That wasn't something new in the New Testament.
The commandments related to that.
Yeah, back in Deuteronomy. We made a point of those. And David showed that several times too, when Saul was coming to kill him and he refused to take up arms against him, when his own son overthrew him and he refused to go get revenge on his son. So here we have another object lesson for a different king of Israel who's a little more slow on the uptake than David was. So verse 24, sometime later, Ben-Hadad, king of Aram, mobilized his entire army and marched up and laid siege to Samaria. There was a great famine in the city. The siege lasted so long that a donkey's head sold for 80 shekels of silver. To give you an idea, 80 shekels of silver is 2 pounds. So, to buy a donkey's head to eat, not the most appetizing meal in the world, would cost you 2 pounds of silver. That's how bad this siege, they block off all the food coming into the city, and all the water coming into the city. So it got so bad that you would have to spend these exorbitant amounts of money for anything that was vaguely edible. A fourth of a cap of seed pods for 5 shekels, that's a little tiny seed pod for about a pound of silver. As the king of Israel was passing by on the wall, a woman cried to him, "Help me, my lord the king." The king replied, "If the Lord does not help you, where can I get help for you? From the threshing floor, from the wine press?" Then he asked her, "What's the matter?" She answered, "This woman said to me, 'Give up your son so we may eat him today, and tomorrow we'll eat my son.' So we cooked my son and ate him. The next day I said to her, 'Give up your son so we may eat him,' but she had hidden him." So this is how bad things have gotten. Israel, okay? Remember the problem that got brought before Solomon? With the two prostitutes? And they both had babies. And the one baby died. And they both claimed that the living baby was theirs. And so Solomon said, "Okay, well, cut the baby in half and give half to each of them." And the one mother said, "Okay." And the other one said, "No, let her have the baby." And so he knew that the one that said, "Let her have the baby," who didn't want the baby to die, was the real mother. Right? Well, we've come a long way. Right? Now it's, "Hey, today let's eat your baby and tomorrow we'll eat my baby." And then we ate my baby, but now she's hidden hers. That's what she needs help with from the king. With her cannibalism. That's not fair. So in verse 30, when the king heard the woman's words, he tore his robes. As he went along the wall, the people looked, and there underneath he had sackcloth on his body. He said, "May God deal with me, be it ever so severely, if the head of Elisha, son of Shaphat, remains on his shoulders today." Why is he going to kill Elisha? Right? He says, "I'm going to go behead Elisha." Well,
Because obviously Elisha's not doing his job. Right? Elisha's job, he's the prophet of Yahweh. His job is to make sure Yahweh does what they want. Right? This is how Baal works. You go and you give the prophets of Baal a bunch of money and a bunch of animals to sacrifice. And they make sure it rains and you have fertile crops, right? It's quid pro quo. So Elisha, if Yahweh isn't delivering them from this horrible siege, clearly Elisha is doing something wrong. So we need to get rid of him and get a new prophet in here who can get results. Okay, that's his thinking. Verse 32, now Elisha was sitting in his house and the elders were sitting with him. The king sent a messenger ahead, but before he arrived, Elisha said to the elders, don't you see how this murderer is sending someone to cut off my head? Look, when the messenger comes, shut the door and hold it shut against him. Is not the sound of his master's footsteps behind him? While he was still talking to them, the messenger came down to him, and the king said, this disaster is from the Lord. Why should I wait for the Lord any longer? The king says, why should I wait for the Lord any longer? Why should I still be patient with him to not do his job? Okay. So do you see how everything's gotten flipped in their heads religiously?
Right.
When he hears about cannibalism going on, and he's horrified, but instead of saying, we're eating our own children, this is why God is judging us, right? This is how wicked we've become. This is why we need to repent, and then God will deliver us, right? It's God is falling down on the job. God is not doing what he's supposed to do. And I'm tired of waiting for him to get it in gear and take out these Syrians. Right?
Chapter 7, verse 1, Elisha said, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Lord said. About this time tomorrow, a seah of flour will sell for a shekel, and two seahs of barley for a shekel at the gate of Samaria. Okay?
So this is basically the reverse of the other. This is you're gonna be giving away wheat for free tomorrow. Okay. From where we are now, you're gonna have so much food, you're gonna be basically giving it out for nothing tomorrow.
The officer on whose arm the king was leaning said to the man of God, look, even if the Lord should open the floodgates of the heavens, could this happen?
He's like, even if even if God just dropped, you know, food out of the sky, how would we get from where we are here with people eating their own children too? There's overabundance of food in one day.
You will see it with your own eyes, answered Elisha, but you will not eat any of it. Now there were four men with leprosy at the entrance of the city gate. They said to each other, why stay here until we die? If we say we'll go into the city, the famine is there, so we will die. If we stay here, we will die. So let's go over to the camp of the Arameans and surrender. If they spare us, we live. If they kill us, then we die.
So these four guys with leprosy, they're having to live outside the city because they have leprosy outside the gate. There's this siege going on. The whole city's surrounded. They're like, well, if we go into the city, they don't have any food, so we die. Right? We sit here at the gate, we don't have any food, so we're going to die. If we surrender, they might take us prisoner or they might kill us. Might as well roll the dice. Might as well surrender to the Syrians and maybe, you know, they'll take us prisoner and give us something to eat. At least there's a possibility.
At dusk, they got up and went to the camp of the Arameans. When they reached the edge of the camp, not a man was there. For the Lord had caused the Arameans to hear the sound of chariots and horses and a great army, so that they had said to one another, look, the king of Israel has hired the Hittite and Egyptian kings to attack us. So they got up and fled in the dusk and abandoned their tents and their horses and donkeys. They left the camp as it was and ran for their lives.
Okay, so sometime as night was falling, the Syrian army, they all start hearing horses off in the distance. Right? They say, oh man, King of Israel must have cut a deal with the Hittites or the Egyptians or somebody and they're coming to attack us. We need to get out of here. So they all took off. So these four guys with leprosy come wandering into the Syrian camp, and nobody's there. Except horses and the donkeys and, you know, the stuff that they left when they ran away. The men who had leprosy reached the edge of the camp and entered one of the tents. They ate and drank and carried away silver, gold, and clothes and went off and hid them. They returned and entered another tent and took some things from it and hid them also. So they say, all right.
They're gone. We hit the jackpot.
They eat up, grab a bunch of stuff, take off with it. Then they said to each other, we're not doing right. This is a day of good news, and we're keeping it to ourselves. If we wait until daylight, punishment will overtake us. Let us go at once and report this to the royal palace. They're like, hey, we really ought to tell everybody else. If for no other reason that if they find this out tomorrow, and they find out we've been looting stuff, they're going to come after us. So let's just go announce this to everybody so everybody will know. So they went and called out to the city gatekeepers and told them, we went into the Aramean camp and not a man was there, not a sound of anyone, only tethered horses and donkeys, and the tents left just as they were. The gatekeepers shouted the news and it was reported within the palace. The king got up in the night and said to his officers, I will tell you what the Arameans have done to us. They know we are starving, so they have left the camp to hide in the countryside, thinking they will surely come out and then we will take them alive and get into the city. So they come and they tell the king, and the king's like, it's a trap. All right, that's his immediate response. Now, Elisha just told him that something like this was going to happen. But, as is typical for this guy, he doesn't believe it. Okay, so he says, this must be a trap. They're going to get us to, they're going to lure us out. We're going to all be outside in the camp. And then they're going to swoop in. They're going to swoop in and capture us and go right into the city and take it. One of his officers answered, have some men take five of the horses that are left in the city. Their plight will be like that of all the Israelites left here. Yes, they will only be like all these Israelites who are doomed, so let us send them to find out what happened. So he says, look, everybody in the city is dying of starvation. Okay? Why don't you get five volunteers, have them ride out and go check it out. Even if they get ambushed, they're dying of starvation here anyway, you know, so what have they really lost? So just go send somebody to check it out. So they selected two chariots with their horses, and the king sent them after the Aramean army. He commanded the drivers, go and find out what has happened. They followed them as far as the Jordan, and they found the whole road strewn with the clothing and equipment the Arameans had thrown away in their headlong flight. So the messengers returned and reported to the king. Then the people went out and plundered the camp of the Arameans. So a seah of flour sold for a shekel, and two seahs of barley sold for a shekel, as the Lord had said. They all go out and pillage. Everybody has so much food. Nobody wants to buy food. Supply and demand, all of a sudden. All of a sudden, food is cheap. Now the king had put the officer on whose arm he leaned in charge of the gate. And the people trampled him in the gateway and he died, just as the man of God had foretold when the king came down to his house. Remember, he said, you won't get to eat any of it? Well, they all trampled him going out to loot. It happened as the man of God had said to the king, about this time tomorrow, a seah of flour will sell for a shekel and two seahs of barley for a shekel at the gate of Samaria. The officer had said to the man of God, look, even if the Lord should open the floodgates of the heavens, could this happen? The man of God had replied, you will see it with your own eyes, but you will not eat any of it. And that is exactly what happened to him, for the people trampled him in the gateway and he died. Okay, so here, remember, God promised he would deliver his people and give them victory if they did the right thing. What we're seeing again and again is that God is still delivering his people even though they're not doing the right thing. Okay? And this is important to notice, because we talked about the idea of a covenant, right? That there's this covenant between God and Israel, this agreement. Okay? And the agreement, as we've pointed out several times, God always says, if. We come to that if. God gives a whole bunch of promises, and then he says, if you follow my ways and do as I've commanded to you. But what we're actually noticing in history is that again and again and again, Israel's not doing the if. They're going in the absolute wrong direction. But God is still faithful to his promises anyway. Right? God is still faithful to giving of his promises anyway. And the reason that's important to note is that it's pretty much the reality in at least my life. I don't know about yours. But the idea we now in the church, we say we're under a new covenant, right? Every time we receive communion, this is the new covenant in my blood, Christ said, about his blood in the Eucharist. We have this new covenant, and there's still that if, right? We still say, we don't say, God just gives salvation to everyone, and it doesn't matter what you do, and it doesn't matter how you live your life, and it doesn't matter what you believe. We don't say that, right? We say, no, you have to, God says, I will give you eternal life, I will give you salvation, I will give you myself. If. But even though, again, I at least don't keep that if very well, God seems to hold up his end of the bargain most all the time. God continues giving me good things all the time, even though I do stupid and sometimes evil things with them. The first time I screw up, God doesn't walk away and say, okay, well, deal's off. <You know? laughs> So much for you. Right? He doesn't do that. We're now about 100 years into the Northern Kingdom's history. Has there been any period of time in that 100 years where any of their kings or any of their priests or any of them have worshipped God the way they were supposed to?
No.
Not 5 seconds. No. Right? As the prophets have come and kept pointing out to them. Right? And they don't learn. But how many times has God delivered them from attacks, from disease, from famine, from over and over and over and over and over again? Because God keeps his end of the deal regardless of whether we keep ours. Now we're going to see eventually here, we're not going to get to it tonight, but in the next couple of weeks, we're going to see here that that doesn't last forever. And that's the sad part. But the part we need to remind ourselves of. God keeps his end of the bargain, but eventually, we get to the end of his patience with our rebellion. Remember, we talked about how the Canaanites, when Israel shows up, God says the cup of their iniquity is full. Right? All the evil they've been doing, right? They've hit their quota. They're not going to do any more evil. He has them wiped out. But there are specific nations, like the nation of Edom, where he said their cup of iniquity is not full. He said, don't attack them. He was still giving them chances. he was still giving them chances. We're going to see, once we get into the prophets, that a few hundred years later, Edom's time is going to have run out, and God's going to proclaim doom for Edom. He's going to say, you've reached the point where it's over. But more importantly, in about 2 weeks, we're going to see with the Northern Kingdom, God's going to say, you've reached the limit, it's over. And at that point, God's going to be able to look at them and say, I kept my end of the bargain. In this case, for 200 years, I kept my end of the bargain.
Been real.
And took care of you and protected you and did all these things for you. And never for a second did you guys come and turn around. Unfortunately, that's true in our own lives too. God is not going to save us against our will. God's not going to drag us into eternal life kicking and screaming. Eventually, we can get to the point, not where God writes us off and damns us to hell, but where we decide hell's where we want to be. And God finally says, okay.
Go.
If that's what you want, you can have it. If destruction is what you want, you can have it. And just like with Israel, he'll be able to say to us when we stand in front of him on the day of judgment, I kept my end of the bargain. Your whole life I was there giving you these things. I gave you life in the first place. I gave you this, I gave you this, I gave you that, I gave you this. You knew all about, you were a member of the Orthodox Church, you knew all about, you know, you had the sacraments, you had the scriptures, you had people preaching at you. Some of them better than others, but you had people preaching at you. I gave you all that, and what did you do with it? Now I'm going to give you what you seem to want. Okay? So, there's both a good and a bad. A good in that God is very patient. But we need to also remind ourselves that patience has an end. As an end. And so we need to not just count on God always being there to bail us out, but we need to repent and take seriously how well we've kept up our end of the bargain. Okay. So chapter 8, I think we have time to do chapter 8 tonight. Now Elisha had said to the woman whose son he had restored to life, we're jumping back a little. Remember, he raised that woman's son from the dead. Go away with your family and stay for a while wherever you can, because the Lord has decreed a famine in the land that will last 7 years. The woman proceeded to do as the man of God said. She and her family went away and stayed in the land of the Philistines 7 years. At the end of the 7 years, she came back from the land of the Philistines and went to the king to beg for her house and land. Okay? Because remember, when they came into the land, we read all about this in Numbers and Deuteronomy, the land was divvied up so that each family had their parcel of land. And that was supposed to be their parcel of land forever. If they sold part of it, then every 50 years you had the year of Jubilee where it got returned to them. Okay, so you wouldn't have one person buying up all the land, right? Everybody would have this spot that they were entitled to, given to them by God. So Elisha had warned this woman there was going to be a famine. He said, go stay somewhere else. She comes back after the famine, and now she wants to go back and settle on her family plot of ground. So she comes to the king of Israel to say, I would like, as it says in the law, it's supposed to happen, I would like my family plot of land to be given back to me. Verse 4, the king was talking to Gehazi, the servant of the man of God, and it said, tell me about all the great things Elisha has done. Just as Gehazi was telling the king how Elisha had restored the dead to life, the woman whose son Elisha had brought back to life came to beg the king for her house and land. Gehazi said, this is the woman, my lord the king, and this is her son whom Elisha restored to life. The king asked the woman about it, and she told him. Then he assigned an official to her case and said to him, give back everything that belonged to her, including all the income from her land from the day she left the country until now. So, she gets it, and she gets back rent. Verse 7, Elisha went to Damascus, and Ben-Hadad, king of Aram, was ill. When the king was told, the man of God has come all the way up here, he said to Hazael, take a gift with you and go to meet the man of God. Consult the Lord through him. Ask him, will I recover from this illness? Yeah. So, remember, one of the main things that Israel was supposed to do was they were supposed to follow God's laws so that other nations would see what's going on in Israel, see how different it was, and so they would want to also follow Yahweh. Okay? Well, we've seen they did a really lousy job at that, right? But who's done a good job at that?
Assyria.
Elisha. Right? The Syrians know Elisha,
yeah.
And Elisha's God, and have seen what he could do. And so they're now the king of this pagan king. Remember Hadad, he's Ben-Hadad. Hadad is one of the other names for Baal. Right? So his name is son of Hadad. Okay, so this pagan king is inquiring of Elisha rather than his own pagan priests and prophets.
So he says, I need to find out, am I going to recover from this illness? So Hazael went to meet Elisha, taking with him as a gift 40 camel loads of all the finest wares of Damascus. He went in and stood before him and said, your son Ben-Hadad, king of Aram, has sent me to ask, will I recover from this illness? Elisha answered, go and say to him, you will certainly recover, but the Lord has revealed to me that he will in fact die. He stared at him with a fixed gaze until Hazael felt ashamed. Then the man of God began to weep. Okay. So Elisha says, go and tell him he's going to get better, but actually he's going to die. Okay. And so Hazael's covered, the king just kind of stares at him. Right? It's like, what? Right? And Elisha kind of stares back at him, and then Elisha begins to weep. Okay. Why is my Lord weeping? Asked Hazael. Because I know the harm you will do to the Israelites, he answered. You will set fire to their fortified places, kill their young men with a sword, dash their little children to the ground, and rip open their pregnant women. Right? So he says, I've seen these horrible things that you're going to do, that you're going to do to Israel. Hazael said, how could your servant, a mere dog, accomplish such a feat? So Hazael says, me? He's like, I'm just the king's servant who he sends on errands. Right? Like, why am I going to go on a rampage through Israel and kill all these people? The Lord has shown me that you will become the king of Aram, answered Elisha. Then Hazael left Elisha and returned to his master. When Ben-Hadad asked, what did Elisha say to you? Hazael replied, he told me that you would certainly recover. But the next day he took a thick cloth, soaked it in water, and spread it over the king's face so that he died. Then Hazael succeeded him as king. Okay, so Hazael not only believes Elisha's prophecy, he sort of takes matters into his own hands.
Smothers.
Right, smothers him. Yeah.
Smothers him.
Oh. And kills him. Verse 16, in the fifth year of Joram, son of Ahab, king of Israel, when Jehoshaphat was king of Judah, Jehoram, son of Jehoshaphat, began his reign as king of Judah. He was 32 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 8 years. He walked in the ways of the kings of Israel, as the house of Ahab had done, for he married a daughter of Ahab. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord. Nevertheless, for the sake of his servant David, the Lord was not willing to destroy Judah. He had promised to maintain a lamp for David and his descendants forever. Now remember, this is the refrain we keep hearing about Judah. Sometimes it's presented in the Old Testament as if Israel was really corrupt and wicked and Judah did better. For what we've seen so far, Judah does basically as bad. But God says, okay, I made a covenant with David. And so for the sake of keeping his covenant with David, he keeps Judah going. Right? Despite the fact that they've become just as bad. And now the proof that they've become just as bad is that now, you know, the king of Judah is married to Ahab and Jezebel's daughter. Right? You don't get much worse than that. In the time of Jehoram, Edom rebelled against Judah and set up its own king. So Jehoram went to Zair with all his chariots. The Edomites surrounded him and his chariot commanders, but he rose up and broke through by night. His army, however, fled back home. To this day, Edom has been in rebellion against Judah. Libnah revolted at the same time. As for the other events of Jehoram's reign and all he did, are they not written in the book of the annals of the kings of Judah? Jehoram rested with his fathers and was buried with them in the city of David, and Ahaziah his son succeeded him as king. So once again, we get the, he was wicked, married Ahab and Jezebel's daughter. While he was king, the Edomites rebelled. As for all the other stuff he did, you can read about that in the you can read about that in his own records. From God's perspective, what's important was he was real wicked. And the only reason God didn't destroy Judah was because he had made promises to David. Verse 25, in the 12th year of Joram, son of Ahab, king of Israel, Ahaziah, son of Jehoram, king of Judah, began to reign. Ahaziah was 22 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 1 year. His mother's name was Athaliah. That's why I have her here.
Ahaziah is the king. Athaliah is his mother. And remember, the queen mother is in office. That's why this is important. And Judah is in office. And remember, she's Ahab and Jezebel's daughter. So do you think that bodes well or ill for what's going on in Judah? His mother's name was Athaliah, granddaughter of Omri, king of Israel. He walked in the ways of the house of Ahab and did evil in the eyes of the Lord as the house of Ahab had done, for he was related by marriage to Ahab's family. Ahaziah went with Joram, son of Ahab, to war against Hazael, king of Aram, at Ramoth-Gilead. The Arameans wounded Joram, so King Joram returned to Jezreel to recover from the wounds the Arameans had inflicted on him at Ramoth in his battle with Hazael, king of Aram. Then Ahaziah, son of Jehoram, king of Judah, went down to Jezreel to see Joram, son of Ahab, because he had been wounded. And this is probably where we'll stop for this evening. And so, as things stand now, Joram, who's Ahab's son, is king of Israel. They're at war with Hazael, who's the guy who smothered Ben-Hadad to become king of the Arameans. Elisha has prophesied that this war is going to go really bad for Israel. The king of Judah is now Joram's nephew. Right? Athaliah is his sister. Ahaziah is his nephew. And because they're related, Judah has now joined in this war with the Syrians. Okay. That's where we're going to leave off tonight. The two kingdoms, even though they're separate, are now allied in fighting the Arameans. And things don't look like they're going to go. And they're not good. Okay, so, if anybody has any questions, thanks for coming out on a dark and stormy night. And we'll pick up at chapter 9 next week. We've got a little bit of 2 Kings left, and then, as I said before, we're going to go through 1st and 2nd Chronicles pretty quickly, because 1st and 2nd Chronicles is basically the same history as we covered in 1st through 4th Kingdoms, or 1st, 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, with a few differences in perspective. So we're going to go through it kind of fast and just highlight those differences as we go through. And then after that, we get into the first book where we're going to shift over to the Orthodox Study Bible, because it's not going to be in your King James Bible. But we'll talk about more about that as we go forward. So thank you, everybody.
Thank you.